In late March 1994, the skies witnessed the maiden flight of Europe's new symbol of military might, the Eurofighter Typhoon. Aircraft engineering companies from the United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, and Spain joined their efforts at the last stage of the Cold War to create a contemporary combat aircraft that would fit their requirements. They couldn't pick any of the available foreign offerings for reasons of pricing, quality, or politics, so the only remaining thing was to design their own machine. The Typhoon's history differs from all other combat vehicles because, unlike most projects, its development stems from multiple disconnected ideas. Germany, for instance, was looking to replace their outdated F-4 fighters with something more modern. They could go for a deep modernization of the Phantoms as a temporary solution, but a permanent option meant building an expensive multi-role fighter like the F-15. Meanwhile, Great Britain and France were both also interested in building a new plane. European nations had already completed a few shared aircraft projects, like the Panavia Tornado multi-role fighter or the Alpha Jet combat trainer. So following the path of joining their efforts once again looked very reasonable. This plane would end up being developed by almost half of all the military companies in Europe at various stages. First, Dornier and a few other companies submitted their projects to a competition announced by German officials. Then, the British Aerospace Defense Company and their German counterparts proposed to join efforts and develop a multi-role fighter together. At some point later in the future, the project was joined by the French. They tried to push the development towards a carrier-based aircraft, but eventually quit the project altogether to develop the future Dassault Rafale on their own. By 1986, four active members remained in the project: Germany, Spain, Italy, and the United Kingdom. The British took on a major role. Their EAP prototype fighter already shared numerous features with the future production version. Air Italia was another big contributor. The company's engineers worked on retrofitting the Tornado production lines to switch to the Typhoon, while also taking part in the development of the tail section and the avionics. In the mid-1980s, the participants finalized their requirements for the fighter. They wanted a twin-engine, intentionally unstable aircraft with fully movable canards and advanced avionics. Despite the fact that the Typhoon had never been designed to be a stealth aircraft, the air intake had a few features to reduce its radar cross-section. Key requirements for the fighter included maneuverability at high speeds and a generous amount of thrust in cruise mode. On top of that, the Typhoon designers wanted it to be equally efficient in missile combat at close and medium ranges, while also being able to deliver ground strikes. Shortly before the end of the development cycle, the Soviet Union collapsed. This event brought an end to numerous promising military projects, including both Soviet and Western combat vehicles. The Eurofighter got relatively lucky. 10 years after its maiden flight, in 2004, the aircraft finally joined active service. Its production was highly unconventional for military equipment. Britain and Germany are mostly responsible for making the fuselage, while Spain and Italy make the wings and the tail sections. Basically, all members of the project are making new Eurofighters together, which is a rare occasion even among successful joint projects. As for the technical solutions envisioned in the 1980s, they remained relevant even when compared to the newest combat vehicles. Despite its late start, the Typhoon found a good place in the international arms market, joining the aircraft fleets of many nations, from the United Kingdom and Austria to Kuwait and Oman.